Pick up the authorized version of the Word of God in front of you in the pew and turn with me to the 7th chapter of the book of Hebrews at page 249 in the New Testament part of the Bible. The 7th chapter of Hebrews. And we are reading from verse 19 to the end of the chapter. Verse 19 to the end of the chapter. We're reading it together, taking your time from me. Don't be whispering it. Let's read it out together. Verse 19 of Hebrews 7. For the law made nothing perfect, but the bringing in of a better hope did, by the which we draw nigh unto God. And inasmuch as not without an oath, he was made priest. For those priests were made without an oath, but this with an oath, by him that said unto him, the Lord swear, and will not repent, thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. By so much was Jesus made a surety of a better testament. And they truly were many priests, because they were not suffered to continue by reason of death. But this man, because he continueth ever, had an unchangeable priesthood. Wherefore, he is able also to save them to the uttermost that come unto God by him, seeing he ever liveth to make intercession for them. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens, who needeth not daily, as those high priests, to offer up sacrifice, first for his own sins, and then for the people's. For this he did once, when he offered up himself. For the law maketh men high priests, which have infirmity, but the word of the oath, which was since the law, maketh the Son, who is consecrated forevermore. Amen. And God will bless his living words to our hearts for Jesus' sake. Last Lord's Day evening, I introduced to you a very interesting subject about the two high priests of the Scripture. If you turn with me to Zechariah chapter 3, at the end of the Old Testament, at page 9 through 32 in your Bible before you, you will find the first one. Both these high priests had the same name. Joshua in the Hebrew, Jesus in the Greek. The first high priest, introduced in the 3rd chapter of Zechariah, was a man in filthy garments with a filthy heart. Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments. And last Sunday night, we saw the sad state of depravity of this man who was supposed to be the high priest of the people of God. But when we turn over to the New Testament, we are introduced not to a filthy priest, we are introduced to a faultless priest. And at the 7th chapter of Hebrews, and at the verse 26, we have this startling contrast to Joshua. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners, and made higher than the heavens. I want this morning to draw your attention to the second great high priest, the Lord Jesus Christ himself. The first priest was clothed in filthy garments. He had a filthy heart, and he did the work of God in a filthy manner. But the second high priest is the faultless Lamb of God. We notice in the third chapter of Zechariah that Joshua was cleansed from all his filthiness. How did it happen? By some religious act, by some dedication to religion? No. It happened by the work of grace in Joshua's heart. Anyone who is cleansed from their heart of sin is cleansed by the free grace of God. Not by an act of religion, but an act of divine redemption. The glorious transformation of Joshua was on the basis of this second high priest, our Lord Jesus Christ himself. Now, seven in Scripture is the number of perfection. And when I came to study this portion of Scripture, I was not at all surprised that there are seven reasons buried in this passage, in Hebrews, why Christ is the perfect high priest. First of all, we are introduced to the perfection of his person. Listen to these words of verse 26. Contrast them with the definition of Joshua and Zechariah chapter 3. For such an high priest became us, who is holy, harmless, undefiled, separated from sinners. Notice carefully this definitive statement, totally opposite to what was written first of all about Joshua. Note carefully the word because. Compare it with chapter 2 and verse 10. The making of Christ perfect through suffering teaches us our Lord's obedience. But the making of Christ perfect to suffer teaches us his great overcoming power. Christ was both human and superhuman, for he was God incarnate. We need to remember three things about Christ. What he ever was, what he became, and what he has done. And when we consider those three things, we will find that Christ fulfilled the law of God. His sacred blood had to be shed for the salvation of his people. If it had not been perfect blood, sinless blood, blood without any trace of any uncleanness. It could not have saved anybody. Christ would need it to be saved himself. But notice what it says. He is holy. He is harmless. He is undefiled. He is separated from sinners. On the last week that our Lord Jesus Christ was upon this earth, he had an argument with the religious leaders of his day. You will find that recorded for you in Matthew's Gospel at the chapter 23. Matthew chapter 23. And it is interesting in this particular passage of Scripture that the Lord Jesus Christ was able to put on record a certain thing. Matthew chapter 22, not chapter 23. Look with me at verse 37. Jesus said to one of his interrogators, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thine heart." That is true holiness. Loving the Lord our God with all our heart. That means you have no love for anything that Jesus himself does not love. That is holiness. Then look at what it says secondly. With all thy soul. What is that? That is harmlessness. When a man loves only the Lord with his soul, that man does nobody any harm. He is harmless. Christ was holy. He was harmless. And then love with all of thy mind. What is that? That's undefiledness. The man that loves God with his mind only is not even defiled in any way. Here was the standard which Christ set up as the only standard God will accept. Now, of course, you have failed the test, and so have I. Dr. Torrey tells of a meeting that he was in, and he was preaching on this text, and he said, "Stand up if you're in the meeting, if you've loved God from the day you were born with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind." And a drunk man in the meeting stood up. And he said, "I'll talk to you afterwards." And afterwards he led that dear man to find the one who loved God with all his heart, and all his soul, and all his mind. There was only one man ever appeared on this earth that from the day of his birth to the day of his death loved God with all his heart and soul and mind, and that was Christ. That's the standard. God does not lower the standard to bring people into the kingdom of God, but God brings people up to the standard. And that's what the great redemption work of Christ was about. He was holy. He was harmless. He was undefiled. He was separated from sinners. One of the greatest presidents that Princeton University had was a man called President Samuel Davies. He wrote these words, "Jesus, how precious is thy name, the great Jehovah's darling thou. Oh, let me catch the immortal flame with which angelic bosoms glow. Since angels love thee, I would love and imitate the blessed above. My prophet thou, my heavenly guide, thy sweet instructions I will hear. The words that from thy lips proceed, oh, how divinely sweet they are. Thee, my great prophet, I would love and imitate the blessed above. My great high priest, whose precious blood did once atone upon the cross, who now doth intercede with God and plead the friendless sinner's cause. In thee I trust, thee I would love and imitate the blessed above. My King Supreme, to thee I bow, a willing subject at thy feet. All other lords I disavow, and to thy covenant and government submit. My Savior King, this heart would love and imitate the blessed above. He was holy. He loved God with all his heart. He was harmless. He loved God with all his soul. And he was without any sin at all, undefiled, because he loved God with all his might. That is the standard that had to be met. And the great high priest, our Lord Jesus Christ, met the standard, the perfection of his person. But look with me again at that verse in Hebrews. Notice the last thing it says, holy, harmless, undefiled, separate from sinners. And then it says this, made higher than the heavens. Here we have the perfection of his position. We have seen the perfection of his person. But here we have the perfection of his position. This refers to Christ's mediatorial work now in heaven. You see, he was humiliated when he was upon this earth. He was despised and rejected of men. He was a man of sorrows. He was acquainted with grief. And he had to pay the blood payment of the cross. But when he had performed the paying of that blood, when he had completed the great work of his covenant with the Father in the covenant of redemption, in satisfying the law and making it honorable, he was carried far above the heavens. He was made higher than the heavens because he had a certain second task to do. What was the second task? He had to ever live to make intercession for us. You know, Christian, why are you here today? Because Christ prayed for you. Isn't it a wonderful thought that this morning, long before you awoke from sleep, Christ in the heavens, far above the heavens, was praying for you. As the great high priest carried upon his breastplate and upon his shoulders the names of the tribes of Israel under the Mosaic law, twice the names of the 12 tribes are mentioned on the garment of the high priest. So the Lord Jesus carries our names, ever living to make intercession for us. He wasn't raised above the heavens to become our high priest, but he was raised above the heavens because he was our high priest. Thou art both priest and sacrifice to save us by thy blood, for us to stand above the skies and intercede with God. He's not only perfect in his person, but he's perfect in his possession. But look again at my text, and you will find the perfection of his place. Those priests that were made without an oath, they died, and their priesthood was finished. But the Lord Jesus Christ is different from every other priest, because he was made a priest by the solemn oath of God. And here in this chapter, we read these words, the words of the Holy Spirit concerning Christ. Verse 21, for those priests were made without an oath. No man swore Aaron in as a high priest. There was no swearing. There was no oath. Why? Because it was only for a short period that Aaron would be high priest. He died, and his son followed him. His son died, and he followed. And so on and so forth. It was a short period of time that man held this office. But Christ is different. He is made with an oath by him who said unto him, the Lord swear and will not repent. Thou art a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. Who was Melchizedek? Of what tribe did he come? We know not. He was without father and without mother. He was made like unto the Son of God. Go back to the book of Genesis. Read about the overthrow of the enemies that came and attacked Sodom and Gomorrah. And the power of Abraham, the friend of God, to defeat them. And when Abraham came back, he was met by this mysterious figure, a man named Melchizedek. He was the priest of the Most High God. It says he was made like unto the Son of God. He was without father or mother, or beginning or end of days. Christ is the oath-bound priest. His place is far beyond any standard or place of Aaron's line. Aaron's priesthood was a failure. It had to pass away. Another priest was needed who would meet the tests of God. That other priest has appeared, none other than our Lord Jesus Christ. And in verse 24 of the 7th chapter of Hebrews we read, but this man, because he continueth ever, hath an unchangeable priesthood. It never changes. It's the same today. It'll be the same tomorrow. And when this world is finished, and God wraps up his first creation, and when the great judgment is opened, those who are sheltering in the blood of this great high priest will be saved forever, because he hath an unchangeable priesthood. How different from the Joshua. The priesthood of Sinai could not do it, but Christ did it, for he was made a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek. But turn again to this chapter, and you will find the perfection of his priesthood. The priesthood of Christ continueth forever. First, God declares he is the high priest. Thou art a priest. Moses said to his brother Aaron, thou art a priest. And made him the high priest under God's direction. But God himself had said to his beloved son, thou art a priest. He says to him, after the order of Melchizedek, without beginning of days or end of time, without father or mother, humanly speaking, the Lord swore it. The oath of God cannot be broken. No power of hell can break the oath of the God that cannot lie. And he told him here, he is a priest after the power of an endless life. As long as Christ lives, I'm pardoned. If Christ should die, I would not be pardoned. But Christ liveth forever. That's why you are saved forever when God saves you. It's not an act of your power that saves you. It is the act of sovereign grace within the heart. God has made him, Christ, his son, a priest forever. My Lord, a priest is made, as where the Almighty God, to Israel and his seed, ordained to offer blood for sinners who his mercy seek, as priest as was Melchizedek. But turn again to my text, and you'll find the perfection of his performance. Look at 25. Wherefore he is able also to save them to the utterance, the uttermost. Why? Because he has performed all that wanted him, all that God demanded of him to do. The priesthood of Aaron failed. Aaron himself became an idolater. Aaron himself was rejected by God, but the Lord Jesus is accepted of his Father. The death of Christ was vastly different from the death of the Aaronic priest. For his death did not prevent him abiding as a priest, as they did. First, he died as a priest. They died from being priests. He died in his office. They died out of office. His personal, their personal death had no part in their work. Whereas to die was the chief priestly duty incumbent upon our Lord Jesus Christ. Third, when they fell under the power of death, they could not extricate themselves from it and return to life and the service of the sanctuary was given to another. But the Son of God had power to lay down his life and had power to take it again. Have you ever studied the miracle that's suggested in those words? He has power to lay down his life. The Bible tells me the blood is the life. The blood is the life. But he shed his blood. He gave up his blood upon the cross. And yet, it says he had power to take it again. But flesh and blood does not inherit the kingdom of God. The blood is something separate. And what happened? He took his life. What life was that? It certainly wasn't the life that was in the blood, for that was shed. It was his life as he knew it, as the eternal God of heaven. Remember who he was. He was God's Son, co-equal and co-eternal with the Father. I have power to lay it down, and I have power to take it again. But he did something. He took his blood with him to heaven. Where did the blood go to when the priest shed it? It was collected in a basin. Precious blood. But it was only the blood of bulls and goats. But Christ's blood is the blood of the Lamb. And when I read this epistle, I read these marvelous words. He entered to heaven by his own blood. With his own blood, having obtained redemption for us. Where is the blood today? The blood is on the throne of God, preserved forever. That's why there's power in the blood. The modernist, the liberal, laughs at the fundamentalist and said, you're only a blood preacher. But I challenge any modernist, any liberal to produce a man converted apart from the blood of the Lamb. Modernism, so-called, liberalism, so-called, cannot see if a tom tit or convert a canary. But thank God Christ can save to the uttermost all that come unto God by him. Why? Because there's wonderful power in the blood. Don't argue with me. I have the experience. It's better felt than tempt. And you can have the experience today of the wonderful cleansing of the precious, precious blood of the Lamb. Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Are you fully trusting in his grace this hour? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Happy the soul that can say, I'm washed in the blood of the Lamb. It has been my privilege for the last 25 years to be a member of the European Parliament and to fly around the world in my capacity as an MEP. I personally do not like flying. I like to be down and out, and I pray that, Lord, make me a pauper quick and get me down and out. But I was thinking of all the thousands and ten thousands and hundreds of thousands of miles in the last quarter of a century I have flown. Why was I protected? I asked myself that question the other day flying home. And they were telling us we were going to have a very rough ride. And I was saying, I don't like these rough rides. I'd like to be down and out. And the Lord said to me, when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the enemy shall not put a finger upon you. Where is the blood? The blood is in the hearts of God's people. When I see the blood, the safety that comes to the believing soul through the blood of the Lamb. You know, it's the blood of the Lamb that's going to bring us into heaven. We come to the end of life's journey, and our battles are all past, and the victory's won. And God calls in heaven for us to appear before Him. How will we get there? Sweeping through the gates of the New Jerusalem, washed in the blood of the Lamb. It's the passport to glory. This powerful blood, the perfection of His performance. Two final thoughts. There is the perfection of His power. It talks about after the power of an endless life. It talks that He lives forever and He's consecrated forevermore. The perfection of His power. And then we have the perfection of His plenitude. And I would invite you to do something, to take the book of Hebrews and ask yourself the question, how many blessings do God's people receive through the death of Christ? And if you study the book of Hebrews, you'll find another seven perfections, another seven. I'll not give them to you, because if I gave them to you, you wouldn't be bothered to search for them. So just look and you'll find seven. Say if you found an eighth one, and there was eight instead of seven. Well, that would even be better, for eight is the number of resurrection in the Bible. So you'd be on resurrection ground. But it takes seven steps to get you to resurrection ground in this epistle to the Hebrews. How deeply thankful every Christian in this house should be that Christ is our great High Priest. The eternal Word became flesh. The Lord of glory stooped to become man. As the God-man, He mediates between the infallible holy God and sinful, hell-deserving sinners. The Savior is none other than Emmanuel, God with us. He is Emmanuel in His humanity, in His suffering, in His bleeding, in His dying, and He is Emmanuel in the glory of His two natures, one humanity and the other deity. We profess not to understand the mystery of His person, but by grace we believe what the Scriptures record concerning Him. That life was given to Christ as the mediator, unlike that of His humanity, was an indestructible one. Therefore, He is a priest forever. And because He's a priest forever, He's living to pray for us. Jesus is praying for His people. Let's bow our heads. Father, we thank Thee for Thy blessed Word. Write it upon our hearts. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, remain, and abide with us evermore. And the people of God said, Amen and Amen.